Okay, thank you all for joining us today. My name is Ben Anderson. I'm an associate professor of sculpture in the Department of Art and Art History here at URI. I'm also current coordinator of the main gallery here in the Fine Arts Center. We will be showing, I'm streaming here from the gallery. Behind me, you can see the work. I'm surrounded by our guest today. The speaker is Albert Chong, from the visual art department at the University of Colorado Boulder.
Nobody is going to ever replace the capacity of a human. And this is why thinking is our number one obsession.
A College of Arts and Sciences education gives you the confidence to bring together all the strands that you value and apply them in ways that are fulfilling for you as an individual, but also resonate out.
You have to really look at schools as a place to grow as yourself. And I think that URI does a great job of that.
There's a sense of pride in the work that you put out there. Students are just excited. Whatever field they're in, they want to be the best at it. And I think that's kind of infectious.
The thing that sets URI apart is that we as a faculty and as an institution ask our students not just what you can do, but who can you be?
Hi, so I am really pleased to announce this lecture with Albert. Albert Chong is an international artist known for his photography. Chong's early work was really earned him critical recognition for his contribution in the multicultural movement in the early 1990s. His art focuses specifically on visual narratives related to race and identity, family, nationalism, mysticism, and spirituality. Chong was selected to be representative artist of his home country in Jamaica and numerous international exhibitions, including Havana, Biennial in Cuba on two different occasions, the Sao Paulo Biennial in Brazil, Johannesburg Biennial in South Africa, and the Venice Biennale in 2001. He's received a number of grants in support of his artwork from prominent institutions such as the National Endowment for the Arts in Photography, a Pollock Krasner grant, and a Guggenheim Fellowship in Photography in 1998. It's really a pleasure to I've known Albert's work for a long time and to watch it develop over the time, and to be surrounded by it in this space is really special. I have one quote that I found of Albert's, and I think it's apt for this show. And he says, "My work has sought to give expression to my human visual intention that operates at levels inhospitable to verbal or literary expression." So I think that's just a really nice statement. And I think with that, please welcome Albert Chong.
Okay, well, hello, gentle people.
Ben, hello, Albert.
Thank you for that very generous introduction.
You've earned it.
Yeah. And yeah, just in terms of history, Ben and I go way back. We were Yeah, we were in grad school together, way back when, at UC San Diego. And yeah, we've been great friends ever since. Anyway, today, I'm so happy to be here. Really feel very honored to be invited to exhibit my work at University of Rhode Island. And to do this exhibition in these incredibly troubled times, it's been a great honor. Today, I'm going to primarily be sharing the work that's in the exhibition, which is about 34 works in the exhibition. There'll be probably around maybe 28 works. A few are sort of repeated with some works are matted with inscribed copper mats, and these are then replicated on in larger sizes. So without further ado, we'll start. I'm going to share my screen. Oh, am I sharing already? Not yet. Let's see. I think I am sharing. Okay. Let me go to the slideshow. Okay. It's not where we should start. Hang on one sec. Go back up. Okay. So I'm going to start out talking about the works with these copper mats, and then I might go a little deeper into the works. In terms of my background, if anybody is curious, I'm originally from Kingston, Jamaica, where I was born and raised. Left Jamaica at age 19 to come to the United States. My family, like many Jamaican families, had immigration inclinations for the most part. I was the last to leave home in 1977 and ended up living in Brooklyn, New York, where I then ended up enrolling in the School of Visual Arts in New York City, and ended up doing photography there for 4 years, and then became kind of involved with the New York art scene during those years. The work you're seeing presently is it's called The Sisters, and it's initially it's a photograph that my mother had sent me because it was the only surviving image that she had of herself as a child. And the image was torn, and she asked me to fix it, which, there was no Photoshop back then. So the best bet was to actually re-photograph it. Having done that, I sort of got carried away and decided to embellish it and turn it into a still life. Later on, I started wondering about photographs, and I think of them as sort of mute testimonies. Meaning that they have all of this amazing information, but sometimes it's difficult to unpack them, and the information can be kind of layered or intuited to some degree. And so I opted to want to extend the meaning and the narrative of some of these images, and to tell some of the background stories behind some of these images, which I don't believe that the image could adequately unpack. And so that led me to using copper sheets that were wrapped around the mats and then were later written into by myself. Sometimes I would make drawings, and I would take journal entries from some of my from my journals. Let me move on. This is an image of my father. And one of these images, this is an image that was, it's part of four images that was rescued from the original shop in Maypen, Clarendon in Jamaica. My parents were shopkeepers, and I sort of grew up in a shop in downtown Kingston. And after we sold the shop in the late 60s, we ended up becoming confectioners. Uptown. So let me move on. So these mats, they, you know, photographs to me have so much power and meaning to them, and the ability to kind of unpack some of these issues and to talk about related or referential issues was somewhat important to me in regards to making these works. So this is called the Trinidadian Venus. So I mentioned grad school earlier. In 1988, I was on my way to, you know, driving my possessions and that of my family, who was going with me, wife and two kids, to San Diego. And I had packed up a whole lot of stuff. And when I started to unpack some of my belongings, I opened up an old patch tube kit that I recovered from Jamaica on one of my trips home, and I was surprised it was still there. And I had put all this stuff in there, and I opened it up and I looked at this thing, and this was the arrangement that I found it in. And it instantly struck me that this was a sort of a automatic still life, that it was just somehow organically arranged itself in this pleasant way. And at the time, I was also working with a large format camera using Polaroid materials, and I loved how Polaroid would do these changes depending on whether or not the parts of the Polaroid was peeled in bright sunlight and would actually change the tonalities of the image. The one on the left is solarized, the other is sort of normal. So it's in the show as a diptych. And it's called As Vulcanization Proceeds, which was what was written on the inside of the can. That refers to the whole aspect of the patch sealing itself on in a tube. So I've also been exploring family histories through family photographs and trying to kind of reflect on some of these images. I had an aunt, Aunt Winnie, who was my mother's sister, and she was always very close to the family and collected a lot of images of the family that had been sent to her over the years. But on a visit to her on my way to Jamaica, I stopped in and I was looking through some of these images, and she loaned me this one of herself. And I took it to Jamaica, and where there is an abundance and a profusion of plants and flowers. And I was staying with a friend and decided to do a select. This is a variation of the actual work. Sometimes I have issues or sometimes just indecision about deciding which particular version. So what you're seeing is this variation of that image. Memory of James Byrd, 2001. So yes, as you're seeing in the title, he was a dragging death victim from Jasper, Texas. Some of you might recall this event. It was a really horrific event in which he was along the side of the road. He might have been hitchhiking in near Jasper, Texas. He was picked up by three white men in a pickup truck. When I'd read the story, I'd read about it in Life magazine at the time and a few other publications. I was, like most people, I was completely horrified, especially by the details of what happened to his body, having been dragged a few miles. The Life magazine article had a photograph of the pickup truck that had dragged him. And I then was fascinated by the IDing the pickup truck, and I zoomed in on the license plate. And this is the license plate of the truck itself. So in 1989, my father died, I was then sent on a mission. He died in Florida, in Miami, where he was living, but we still had our family home and headquarters in Kingston. And he did not leave a will, as we know, but I was sent on a mission to look for a will. And so I went through a process of going through a lot of his paperwork, a lot of his papers, and I would find all kinds of letters and stuff, and a few items would pique my interest. This was an old style speeding ticket where he was speeding along Red Hills Road in St. Andrew. You know, I just liked how it looked. It's so different than the kind of form that we see today in terms of tickets. And so decided to do a little embellishment with it, you know, turn it into a sort of little still life to commemorate that event. Never did find a will. He was somebody who was a justice of the peace and did many wills for many people. But like most of us, you know, I think most of us have an issue about confronting our mortality. And I think he was no different. This is my maternal grandmother, Louise Hines. And for years, I didn't know who she was or didn't have any images of her until I found out that an aunt, my Aunt Beryl, actually had a photo. In those days, way back when, especially in places like Jamaica, people did not have a whole lot of access to the technology to, you know, to either have photographs made of themselves, especially as they grew through time, and were only photographed on special occasions. And so this was probably the case with her. She left Jamaica when my mother was an infant and ended up in what's called British Honduras, which is, at the time, where she died, I think in childbirth. So we're gonna go on to the self-portraits. When I arrived in New York from Jamaica, I was experiencing a bit of culture shock. And I guess I'm not sure why, because, you know, I'd been coming to New York since, you know, each year since acclimatizing since 1974. But the shock of having been there permanently and leaving an entire life behind, I was still coming to terms with. And I had also, you know, started an art school and was trying to figure out, you know, what kind of contribution I would be able to make in terms of the photographic medium. And I ran into logistical issues in regards to, you know, setting up appointments to shoot models or people for my ideas. And eventually I became real frustrated and decided, well, it was real difficult to communicate what my ideas were to these models and everything else. So I decided, well, why don't I photograph me? I know what I want and I'm always here. I don't have to make any appointments. So I started doing these self-portraits and I ended up calling them the eye traits. The I in eye traits is a reference to Rastafarian dialectics, Rastafarian language in Jamaica, in which the I, the term I and I, usually is a reference to an extended brotherhood. So and this work is called Leaning on the Palo. And there is some dried up bushes in the background. I won't talk about these plants. These are stuff I used to grow to smoke at the time. And I have a burlap background, which is we call in Jamaica crocus bag. There's feathers on the floor, and then there's coconuts and a gourd. These works, I was actually trying to create a kind of my own idea of a cosmology about the links between Africa, Jamaica, and my now new life in the United States. And this is a self-portrait that was done for publicity for an installation work of mine. It's called Winged Evocations, that had that was funded by Oberlin College in Ohio, and then had traveled quite a bit around the country. And so the wings are rawhide. I'm wearing a jacket that's covered with pine cones. And the piece had like five figures that were representative of myself and that had on these weird suits and were kinetic in effect, meaning it had, once you walked into the space, there was a motion sensor that would set the wings beating, and the wings would beat to an old tune by the Wailers called Wings of a Dove. This is not in the exhibition, but It somehow I couldn't fit it in the crate at the time, but it's an image that's near and dear to my heart. It was what I might regard as my first, it was the first image I ever sold, and also the first image that I would consider a sort of a signature image. It's called The Natural Mystic, and it is named after a song by the late Robert Nesta Marley, Bob Marley. And one of those images that was just burned into my head. I saw it clearly in my head, and I had no idea I'd be able to kind of manifest it in much the same way it was in my mind's eye. Figurative still life. I guess the aim here was to figure out how to combine, the figure, the body within a still life setting. This is what these were about. And I was working with really long exposures. At this time, there were, this was the time of analog photography, film. And so it took a while to figure out the time exposures and how much to move without disappearing completely from the image to be able to master this process to make these images. And unfortunately, back then we had no feedback loops. I couldn't see what I had. I had to wait until the film was developed to see whether or not I had what I was after. All right, self-portrait with Garvey's prison docket. Some of you might know of a Jamaican revolutionary, Pan-Africanist, Black nationalist, you also call Marcus Garvey, Marcus Messiah Garvey. He's a Jamaican national hero, but he was one of these individuals who preceded the American Civil Rights Movement. He had launched an organization called United Negro Improvement Association, of which people like Malcolm X's father was deacons in this. And it was generally a movement to instill Black pride and to actually enable repatriation to Africa, which was never actually accomplished, but it was worth a try. He was later tried, and charges were trumped up against him, and he was deported to Jamaica. So self-portrait as an antelope. I have a real fascination with organic materials, with skulls and bones and feathers and anything organic for the most part. I also earlier on was somewhat influenced by Frida Kahlo's work, especially her works where she paints herself as an antelope. So this might have been an unconscious homage or homage to Frida Kahlo. Self-portrait with the baboon skull. And this one is also in the exhibition. And I guess I've been trying to figure out the essence of life, of living beings, of what's left behind when that life departs. What are these bones all about? And the skulls, generally, I think of as the vessel, the container of consciousness, of the mind. And so these were portraits that were meant to consider these issues in regards to life and the departure of life and the remnants of that life. So portrait as the Buddha. This is a sort of a roundabout image to talk about in that it started out with a former grad student of mine who was working with honey. She had all these honeycombs in her studio at the university. And the heat went up and the honey melted from the combs. And she asked me to come down and scoop up whatever honey I could from the floors, which was still usable, and which I did. But the honey had a lot of wax in it. And so whenever I would make tea and sweet my tea with the honey, I would scoop the beeswax off the top of the tea and I would roll it into these little balls. And I didn't know what I was going to do with these little wax balls. That's what saved them. And eventually, I found an old photograph that I had made of myself, and somehow this ended up. I ended up using these little wax balls to kind of create this image that I thought resembled the Buddha. And Buddhism is somewhat a sort of another influence in my life in regards to one of the most benevolent religious systems on the planet. I won't spend time explaining. So, throne for the ancestors. So this became another series. After the end of the self-portrait series, the eye trait series, I then turned my focus to chairs. This was a chair that I'd found on the streets in my neighborhood in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. And at the time, I was also, you know, cooking, trying to learn how to cook Jamaican food at the time, and especially using salted cod, which we call saltfish in Jamaica. And it's become part of the national dish of the island, but initially it was really about slave rations. Jamaica is a former slave colony of Great Britain, of England. And as such, the food that was given to a lot of these enslaved peoples were salted pork, salted beef, salted cod, anything salted that could keep. And so eventually this kind of affected our health in regards to having us kind of a salty palate. But I ended up using the codfish to cover the chair, and had made this photograph around 1988. And it was shot on the roof of my building against a tarred black wall. And I didn't quite know what it was about or, you know, where it was going. And it wasn't until much later that it would come in to terms. I regard it as a heralding image. Images that sort of come out of nowhere, which is sort of trying to tell me that there is something here and I should follow it. It was actually the same case with the natural mystic image that you saw earlier. Thrown for the justice. So in 88, I was off to grad school in California, where I then started thinking about that chair we saw before, the throne for the ancestors, and how it relates to a future body of work. And so I then started kind of collecting old chairs and trying to figure out how to embellish them. In California, I became fascinated by giant pine cones. These are these massive things that could kill a person if they fell from the heights that they do, because they're really massive and massive kind of thorns. Anyway, I had what you're seeing on the chair as well around here is my dreadlocks, which had been shorn at the time, and a picture of my father with cowrie shells. My parents weren't very happy about my influence, or what should I say, about my participation in the Rastafarian movement. Might be a better way of putting it. And so I remember my mother always saying she was going to cut my locks when I was asleep or something like that. So anyway, I decided to use it in this photograph, memorializing my father. And thrown for Elegua being an Orisha of the Santeria pantheon, along with my dreadlocks and a book, which I call the naming book, became a book that I would paste photographs in and then figure out titles for them. Eventually, I end up becoming really fascinated by the whole business of collecting the images in the book. I ended up covering all the pages with copper sheets that made the book bow open. One other thing, I was also really fascinated by the materials I was using. I normally would be shooting on black velvet, and the black velvet would change tonalities and would go gray when certain batches of this Type 55 Polaroid film would do this reversal and would actually do what we term solarization, which is actually closer to what's the Sabatier effect. thrown for the keeper of the boneyards. You know, I excuse me. I still collect eggshells. It's a habit that started way back in the 80s when I became fascinated by the perfection of this vessel that was an egg and how, you know, how perfect it was as a container. And so when I would cook eggs, I would just, you know, break open the top and, you know, and kind of flush out the contents and save the shells. And eventually I ended up with like boxes and boxes of eggshells. And I still do that today, but now I crush them up and put them in my compost. But back then I saw them as these perfect vessels. And I started using them in still life assemblages, as in the case here. The keeper of the boneyard is referring to a Haitian loa named Baron, the Baron's Samedi. So all of these are on black velvet, and the tonalities have been reversed. This is the two generations in which I am actually making a connection between my father and myself in regards to a passport of mine from 1966. And around it is actually a bird necklace from New Guinea that was given to me by a fellow grad student at the time as well, Bob Harris. And Untitled Throne with Crucifix, Water, and Dreadlocks. This was somewhat influenced by the censorship battles of the late 1980s, early 1990s, especially in regards to an artistic friend and acquaintance, Andres Serrano. And he had told me of the situation that he was going through in regards to his work called The Piss Christ. And I started thinking about the crucifix and how it's been used as a tool for colonization and for slavery as well, primarily slavery. And so I, you know, of course, you know, I was raised Catholic as well, but wanted to kind of undo the negative aspects of the cross. So here it's sitting in a glass of water, my dreadlocks. All right. And this is the last image. And this is the throne for the gorilla spirits. And this one has a copper mat on it as well. Unfortunately, some of the issues with working with these copper mats, I guess I had half of my audience was telling me that they liked it. The other half was saying they couldn't deal with it because the one half was more the purist who loved photography and was only interested in just the image. And so people would be telling me, oh, it's distracting. It takes away from the image. The image is strong enough already. You don't need to do this. But I was still very much interested in the idea of these copper sheets. They reminded me, the reference for me was illuminated manuscripts, medieval illuminated manuscripts from the Byzantine period. I love those. And this was sort of my reference or my attempt at a sort of emulation for these. But once glass got placed on these works, it became virtually, well, not impossible, but very difficult to photograph and to reproduce. And so some of these works that were made were photographed initially before they were framed. And some of the files might have gotten corrupted or lost or what have you. But yeah, at some point I'm going to have to sit down and re-photograph some of these works. And that's all, folks.
thank you, Albert. That's great. So I want to thank you for that, but also I want to introduce, we're going to expand the discussion here a little bit, and we'll be joined by my colleague and yours, Anu Palakanutha. Sorry. I'm staring right at it. I can't see. Anu Matthew Palakanathu Matthew, is a professor of photography in the Department of Art and History. She's very active in her own international career, including numerous international exhibitions, and was a long time director of humanities. And so thank you, Anu, for coming in and sharing this stage with Albert and talking about your field. So,
Well, thank you, Ben. Yeah, and thank you, Ben, and thank you, Albert, for that wonderful talk.
And I think we also
have another connection because we're in Kingston, Rhode Island, and you're from Kingston, Jamaica. So there's multiple connections.
Uh-huh. It's not lost on me.
So I think we're going to start actually with a question from one of my students, Nancy Wojak.
I was really intrigued by the matting process, in particular with your use of copper. Can you speak to us about your choice of material and tell us how it adds to the presentation? And can you also explain the process that was used?
I discovered the copper sheets when I was in grad school. I had a studio mate who was actually working with copper at the time. And she gave me a little piece I had to take a phone call, and it was underneath a sheet of paper I was writing on. And next thing I know, I saw it had imprinted through the paper that I was writing on into the copper. At first, I was very kind of disturbed that I messed up this whole sheet. But then it occurred to me, maybe that's what it's for. And so I discovered that this copper being a sheet, it was very soft and was easy to kind of to trace images into, to write poetry into, to write stories into. And so I was taking a lot of images, a lot of stories from my journals, and then just stuff I was thinking about. And sometimes if I was listening to a particular piece of music, it would end up in there because it would just seem right at the time when you're listening to lyrics. But in terms of the process, it's really about making mats and then putting adhesive, like a sort of double stick tape around it, and then wrapping the mats with this. And for me, it, as I mentioned earlier, it was a way of kind of expanding on this narratives and the meaning of the photographs themselves. Let's see if I'm remembering all of the question. I'm not sure if I remember the rest of her question, but yeah, that primarily was the process. Unfortunately, copper is very expensive these days. I mean, it's a non-renewable resource in terms of extractive mining. And so I've watched its price kind of triple, quadruple over the years. And so at a certain point I said, well, I can't keep doing this anymore. And also I was conflicted about doing them in general, just because I guess maybe I was too open to criticism, to individual feedback. And I took it seriously. People said, you shouldn't do that. It really destroys the image. And I go, well, I don't know. And so I had half of my audience who loved it. The other half thought I was really messing up my photos. But eventually I kind of moved on from that. I constantly think about returning to it, but I've not gotten around to it yet. Okay.
So I think we have a question. How has digital affected photography? You spoke about the feedback loop of analog photography. How has mm-hmm. that changed now with digital?
Well, as I sometimes say to my students, I really, I think about what it would have been like for me and for a lot of my peers to have had digital cameras during the time when we were really active, or we're all still active. But the fact that the only feedback loop we had back in the day was Polaroid, mm-hmm. Polaroid film. Otherwise, you didn't know what you're going to get until you processed the film. And so Polaroid was really instrumental in helping me kind of advance my work at a much faster pace. not having to, you know, wait for film to be developed. I could, you know, peel the thing and see what was necessary and make my changes. So I think, man, if I could look on the back of my camera and see what was going on, as well as the cameras these days have are amazing machines, amazing tools. You know, just the quality of the video, time-lapse features, on and on and on and on. When I look through this thing, I am like totally blown away by this tool. And I think, well, I love my old film cameras as well, but they don't quite compare. I mean, the beauty of film is that you end up with a negative, which is a hard thing, something you can hold on to. With digital files, there is no real future as such because the technology changes so much. I guess I think about it in terms of, say, cuneiform tablets from Mesopotamia, all right, from way back when. We can still access those cuneiform tablets. They can still be read. But a lot of our technology, let's say VHS tapes, or even audio cassette tapes, or even reel to reel, I could go on, CDs, a lot of that stuff will not be accessible to us because we don't have the ability to play it back, to keep these things working and everything else. And so the beauty, what I miss most in regards to being part of the digital process is the negative and the film. Is the negative and the slides, is having an actual thing that I know exactly where it's at and I can go find it and work from it. And so that is the main drawback for me. What I absolutely love about digital is that I can produce a print from a really good scan that I wouldn't have the ability or the skill or the patience to make in the darkroom.
Wow.
You know, I mean, that first image I showed you, that image called The Natural Mystic, is a print that's always bedeviled me. It would take me sometimes 10 tries to get it right. And now, with a good scan of that negative,
yeah,
I get it right every time. Yeah. No problem. You know, I go in, I wouldn't, you know, I'm not wasting paper or chemistry or any of that stuff. And so I love the ability to make absolutely good prints, just because I can completely control my highlights and my shadows and my midtones in the scanning process and don't have to deal with that in the dark room.
Yeah.
Sometimes I look at some of my old prints or even prints of some of my peers and say, man, that's really dark. And sometimes we weren't able to step back and to really look at the full scale that's necessary to make a really good print. But then the downside is there is an entire market for people who just want gelatin silver prints, you know, and I can't go there again. You know, I'm just not, you know, I love the darkroom. I absolutely loved it. I would spend days in there at a time, you know, but I just can't go back there. It's I'm too far down the rabbit hole in regards to digital, the digital revolution. I love it and I hate it at the same time. Let's just put it that way. I love the convenience. I love the ease. I love the fact that I don't need a color processor or to be dealing with, you know, color chemistry in a dark room in total darkness like we used to do back in the day at SVA, or rolling a tank around on a countertop with chemistry and making prints. It was just nuts. And having to keep temperatures at 100 degrees Fahrenheit, you know, and all of that. And so, nah, I won't go back. But the negative thing is, it's really crucial for me. The reason I bring in the cuneiform was I was invited to Lubbock, Texas, to Texas Tech. And I was given a tour of their rare books library and their collection. And the person in charge of the thing showed me these cuneiform tablets. And they were just these little clay things that had been baked with like these little inscriptions in them. But in holding these things, I realized this information is still here. And so much of our information will be gone in the not too distant future. I'm always having trouble with corrupted files as it is, you know, constantly. But I don't, the future is real iffy in regards to our technology.
On one hand, your work is so transcendent, but and kind of almost not there. But on the other hand, you want that permanent physical object. So there seems like a little bit of contradiction.
Well, isn't that what humanity is all about? Art itself is like a contradiction in terms. I mean, you know, how we deal with it and how it changes, and you know, our conceptions about what it is or what it means, how that changes depending on who's talking about it. So yeah, you're right. The work tends to want to be ephemeral, hope to be transcendent, you know, hope to be meaningful, but I also want it to be around. You know, I also want it to last. I also, you know, want to deal with it with as much convenience as possible without having to go through the hoops of chemistry and technology and all of that other stuff.
So I think next, oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I think next we have a question from a student of both Ben and mine, Ashley
Hi, my name is Ashley LaBarbara, and some of the questions I had after looking at the piece in the gallery were, why did you choose a copper mat in particular? What was the story or the deciding factor that led to choosing that material? Because not only did it carry the narrative and it connected all the pieces, but I found it very interesting to pause and to look at all the natural animals depicted, like the frog, for instance, I really love that, or the spiritual elements that were also carved into that copper. I thought that was something that really made me pause during the show. And also, Your Father's Speeding Ticket, one of my favorite pieces. I really love the composition, and I would love to know the story behind that particular piece. And I think that the way you put flowers on top of the actual paper is something that I would love to try in my own photography class with a new. And for your self-portrait and for your Aunt Winnie's, were there any particular reason you used antelope, like the reins of the antelope, or the yellow flowers for your aunt? I was wondering if there's any particular meaning behind that, because I also really enjoyed the portraits as well. Thank you.
Okay. Wow. Well, going back to the copper mats, like I mentioned earlier, it was because it was shiny and beautiful and gold colored, you know, and who isn't attracted by gold colored metals, even if they're not gold? You know, copper is as close as I could come to gold in regards to this. And, you know, I guess I would have gone with, you know, what gold leaf if I could, but that didn't quite kind of hold up over time. But it, as I mentioned before, it was also the influence of illuminated manuscripts around the Byzantine area. I love this idea of monks working constantly, you know, as scribes, you know, writing. And the stuff in the margins was sort of just play. It was almost decoration. What was most important was the text that they were transcribing. But the gargoyles and the monsters and the creatures and the animals, it was all this kind of medieval whimsy, which I was just totally fascinated by. And so without really realizing it, in looking back, I realized I was sort of emulating those medieval manuscripts, you know, by doing this. And it was like, also, as I said, also is a way of extending the stories about the photographs so that, you know, I could actually get people to kind of get into my head in regards to some of my notions and meanings behind these images and how they were made and what the stories were behind some of the people in the images. And sometimes it's random. Sometimes you run into a whole bunch of song lyrics in that, you know, sometimes it's stuff from my journals from like 20 years ago. Other times it's, you know, occult symbols, you know. So I never know really what I was gonna get. And what was the other part? Oh, the other part of the question was about flowers. And I was using flowers as a form of memorializing. for these past for these individuals who are significant people in my family. What it was is being the last child of a large family, I didn't feel like I knew the history really well. And so I became somewhat fascinated by the family album and by old photographs in general. And I realized the importance of old photographs in regards to our personal histories and our voyage through the world, through time. I know one or two individuals who have no photographs of their childhood. Either they got lost in fires, or they moved and couldn't take it, or any number of reasons. And to not be able to kind of track your journey through the world through images, it's become a fundamental notion of human identity in regards to the fact that without a photographic recording of one's time or presence on the planet, it's almost as if we never existed. It's almost as if there is no record of our existence. And so, yeah, that all of those things came into my thinking about the preciousness of family photographs and of those photographs from my family that I could then release to the world by memorializing these individuals and talking about these family histories, because these are not histories that were that the mainstream world considered relevant to our times. You know, generally we are hearing the stories of, you know, generally well-heeled, affluent, primarily people of European descent, or, you know, but yeah. So hoping I'm answering that question well. I wonder if there was any other parts of that question I missed. It's a problem with complex questions. You forget what.
Yeah. I think we have we have another one that Leah's going to say. In what direction do you see your photography going in the future?
Well, this question is from my sister. Wonderful. My youngest sister, you know, who's like 5 years older than me. Anyway, she's asking, in what direction do I see photography going? Was that the question?
No, your photography.
Oh, my photography. I really don't know. I mean, I'll take it wherever it'll lead me. Sometimes I feel like I'm at a, you know, brick wall with a lot of my photography. Sometimes I have no ideas whatsoever. Sometimes I'm lacking complete inspiration. And then other times I'll get a burst of inspiration and then I'll just start making stuff. But I tend to work intuitively. And I know that's sort of a bad word in contemporary art. It's sort of right up there with beauty. Right?
So I have a last question. Mm-hmm. You know, you played your work and you played a role in the whole multicultural movement. And could you explain what your role was in it? And do you think it's had some lasting effects on photography and contemporary art?
Well, I don't know that my role was very important. It's just that I came of age in, 1981, when I got out of art school. And I realized that a whole lot of us, a lot of artists of color, we were in the same boat in New York. And we couldn't get any venues to show our work. And so we were pretty much relegated to nonprofit spaces for the most part. And that's when I started seeing a coalition of individuals starting to come together that included not just artists, but important curators who are around today. I'll name some of the main names. You would have been the main one in my life would have been Deborah Willis, who was at the Schomburg at the time. And in my last year in art school at SVA, I had done a senior exhibition and it had gotten really, you know, it was regarded as, you know, people liked it. Let's just put it that way. That's the way of putting it. But I had a friend in my thesis class who said he had a show at the Studio Museum, and he said, you know, you really should go uptown to see this guy named Danny Dawson at the Studio Museum, who's a photo curator there. I think he would like your work. So I called him up and went up there to see him. And he was really quite impressed with the work. was so impressed that he got on the phone immediately. And who was he calling? Deborah Willis at the Schomburg. He was at the Studio Museum. She was 10 blocks away. And from him, I went to see her. And those two individuals then kind of keyed me in to this new movement that was taking place at the time in New York. As the people who had gotten art history degrees and who had museum studies backgrounds were then able to start organizing a lot of us artists who were looking for places to exhibit. And so the other names I should mention would be Kelly Jones and Fred Wilson, who's a So Fred was doing a lot of shows at up in the Bronx at a Longwood Art Center. And he was also curating exhibitions through just above Midtown, downtown, with Linda Good Bryant, which was her gallery. And that's where I first met Fred when he was manning the reception counter. And I walked in and go, yo, how does a guy get a show around here? How does it work?
And Fred goes, won't work now.
It almost didn't work then either. But it was a cool space. I mean, downtown, you had David Hammonds, who was hanging out in the basement, you know, and you know, Greg Tate, Iron Man Greg Tate, he was sort of living in the basement, you know, and all this stuff was going on around that gallery, and they gave me a show. You know, Fred was actually one of the ones who helped kind of put it together. And it's not a show that I'm real proud of, because I was still very naive back in those days in terms of that work. I will talk about what the works were at the time, but eventually these individuals ended up becoming better known and better respected. And eventually by 1988, I had gotten my first offer to show at the National Museum of American Art in an exhibition called the American Pictures of the 1980s. And that's when I realized things were really starting to change, because people were now being taken seriously. The art world realized that this wasn't just about white artists or white male artists, you know, and I'd gotten a ton of rejections going into galleries and places with my portfolio. I mean, too numerous to even talk about. Many of the times, you know, they would kind of slip up and think I was the messenger and would go off about how they love the work and that that me being the messenger should tell the artist that they want to give them a show. And I'd open my mouth and said, no, I'm the artist. And that would be the end of that. And so those are the sort of like kind of regular everyday racist issues. Let's just say in my final year as an undergrad student, I realized that I would never have the equal opportunities that my white peers had, meaning that my struggle would be two or three times as difficult because of the hurdles that would be put in my way. And it wasn't just me. It was a whole lot of us who was going through it. And of course, you know, people like the Gorilla Girls and there's a few other groups that took on a lot of these issues to do with exclusionism in the arts, you know. And so, yeah, I can't say that I was a great participant. My participation had to do with being in those exhibitions at the time, some of which were sort of groundbreaking, and to getting to know these individuals.
Well, yours was some of the first work that was non-white that I saw. So to me, you did play a role.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
So I think we're ready to wrap up. So yeah, Ben, and thank you so much for your honesty and your, you know, just sharing so many of your experiences today. But I'm going to hand it over back to Ben.
Yes, okay. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Anu, for
thank you.
Thanks, Albert. So, you're welcome. Thank you for being here and sharing all of what you've just given us. But just so everyone knows, this show is going on, and I'm surrounded by the works, and to see them in person is the real way to look at this work, and to be to sort of commune with it one on one, I think is a real experience. So. We'll wrap up. I want to thank Albert Anu, and I want to also thank Leah Cooper, who helped us with video and social media specialist. That's her role. And James Jung, technical support. Chris Anderson in our department, who's a technologist, and Mary Malicorn, our department administrator. And this whole talk is made possible by the Provost's Office, the Distinguished Visiting Artist Program. So thank you all.
Never has it been more critical to advance science and technology and educate and equip our students for today's challenges. Modernizing and upgrading existing facilities that have seen little change in more than 50 years will help to create an environment where our students can thrive and succeed. Vote yes on question one to invest in students, in higher education, in Rhode Island.
I'm Kyla Pecchia.